All right, well, thanks. It's fantastic to be in Finland. First time actually in Europe, like all together. So I'm definitely excited to be here. And I came in yesterday from Southern California with my wife and three kids. So we've kind of made a whole adventure around it. Today I want to talk about, it's kind of interesting as we see these conferences and trends begin to emerge and certain, things begin to be brought up time and time again. And hopefully what I have to say definitely reinforces and also kind of expands upon these trends that we've seen, like with all the fantastic speakers this morning. So I want to talk about beyond pixels. So I think, as designers, we have very obvious skills about the way that we visually communicate. But I think that there's also something a little bit more beyond just the design and the aesthetic that we actually create, but actually becoming conscious about the aspects of design and our process to become exceptional designers. And I'm really interested in what happens beyond the pixels and outside of the pixels as we begin to think about design. Have you ever been lost in a moment, so wrapped up in what you're focusing on, whatever you're doing, that you completely lose track of everything? Living in Southern California, every now and then we'll make it out and go surfing, and there's times whenever you're in the water, there's waves coming in, you're constantly having to do things and adapt to what's happening around you. But also in that time, you kind of lose track of everything else. You're not thinking about work. You're not thinking about, everything else that you have to deal with when you're out of the water. But you're completely lost and wrapped up in that moment. And I think even as we approach design, we kind of get in that same mode too, where we're so focused on the visuals and the certain steps and the certain processes that we have to do to be able to communicate a design. And we'll, focus in a little bit closer and we'll look at like those details, even all the way down to the pixel level, which is definitely good. But I think it's a lot, very important to begin to think about what else there is to design and what are the things that influence design and who we are as designers and what helps us communicate that design in a better way. So what are the traits and qualities that a good designer has? As you're thinking about, what is it that makes a good or exceptional designer? What does it take? You might think taste and the way that the things that you value as a designer and the way that you begin to express it visually. Or maybe is it style, the particular unique flavor of design that you like to go to that kind of makes your work interesting or your work in demand with a particular type of client or user. Balance, the way that you can balance out, both the visual and then the, everything that's written in the design and the way that you're kind of balancing the two. Or passion, are you passionate about the work that you're doing? Because ultimately it comes across in your work. But I think that there's even a kind of a deeper level as far as like what it takes to be an exceptional designer. As I was preparing for this talk, I asked some people on Twitter, what they thought a good designer has as far as qualities. And I got a whole bunch of responses. This one says a process, flexibility and dedication to perfection, curiosity, in digital empathy for the user, convictions in your ideas, but courage to accept when you're wrong and fighting the right battles. Patience, passion, empathy. Think more, design less. Determination, thick skin, playfulness. Confidence, ambition, and humility and patience, not necessarily a balanced mix. Communication, humility, driven to learn and to seek answers beyond themselves. Empathy, again, clarity, a lack of perceived opinions, good communication skills, good looks, ability to bridge the gap between ideas and reality, and compassion over empathy, expressing or establishing two-way trust with a team and collaborative. And so I think, as we're looking at like all these different attributes, many times we focus our skills on the visual language and the way that we visually represent whatever it is that we're creating, and that's what we pour a lot of attention, that's what we pour a lot of time into honing that craft. But as you begin to think what makes a good designer, a lot of that exists beyond pixels and beyond what you typically think of design or what you would practice to get better at. So, you know, the majority of the people, the topics that kind of came up is empathy, action, clarity, courage in your work. And a lot of that goes beyond, you know, typography and colors and all these other visual elements. You know, so how much time do you spend thinking about your process whenever it comes to the elements beyond the visual design? You know, how much time do you spend searching for just visual inspiration? You know, I think that is to shift into being a good designer, you have to learn to kind of look beyond that and to look for inspiration outside of just the visual trends and putting effort into improving our processes as design. So today I want to talk about two different aspects of beyond pixels. First, looking at the external and the way that we go through the screen and reach and actually establish a connection with a user, a real person on the other side. And how it begins, our designs can begin to shape their world and allow us to make a connection with them. And then also internal. So even thinking about like the way that we are feeding ourselves like in design and the important things that play into that to make sure that we have the great qualities and the traits to be a great designer. And then, you know, moving ideas into action, and then the way that we approach challenges, the way that we handle fear, the way that we feed our creativity. There's a lot of that goes into play. And so I think that in order for us to be able to put out our best work day after day, we have to develop discipline. Discipline about the way that we approach design, the way that we approach, you know, all these things. And just like the scene that's kind of faded back here from Karate Kid, you know, he has him sanding the floor and painting the fence, and he's, you know, kind of confused, like, why am I doing all these other things? I want to learn karate so I can, you know, seek out revenge against the bullies. But really what it was about all these things that we need to establish as a part of discipline to be able to, whenever we do have that aha moment or we have that moment of inspiration, what can we do to take that moment of inspiration to begin to act on it in design and in the way that we approach it visually? The same way whenever, you know, we look at an empty Photoshop screen, or if you're designing directly in the browser or whatever your process is, you know, there's a certain discipline that it takes to be able to look at an empty screen like that and to be able to kind of get the ball rolling and get everything out there as you're creating static designs. But there's a lot more that goes into that and plays into that. And so a lot of what it takes to go from this screen to an actual design or a representation of where you're going is it takes pushing and just minimizing the amount of time that you're spending thinking about decisions and just get the ball rolling. The same thing with whenever you're writing. I knew that going into this today, to fill 45 minutes, it would probably take 10,000 words. And in order to be able to get to that point, I had to just start, you know, getting all the words out there on the screen and not even worrying about drafting or editing as I go, but just get it all out there. And then through a process, refine it and improve it. There's a book, Thinking Fast and Thinking Slow by Daniel Kahneman. And he talks about these two different systems, the way that we approach problems and the way that we think. The first is thinking fast, where it's very automatic and it's emotional and it's just subconscious. And as designers, as we improve our visual skills, we can begin to think very fast about the way that we're going to communicate visually. But then on the flip side, you have thinking slow, where it's a lot, you know, more methodical and it takes a lot more effort. We don't use it as frequently, but that's a very powerful way to approach the problems and to really thinking, you know, deeply about the way that we approach design. And as we begin to look at ways and set up practices and disciplines for these areas outside of the visual, I think that, you know, we can begin to develop trails and paths that over time it feels familiar, and we can shift from thinking slowly about the way that we think about design to it's just a part of our habit and it's a part of the way that we move forward. So in thinking about external and what that means and the way that our design impacts people around us and the way that it touches other people. You know, there's a story about IBM that really came to mind that in the early 1990s, they were in crisis. The company was failing. They laid off thousands of people. For the first time in history since the company was in existence, their revenue and their profits were collapsing. And many analysts were thinking that they were going to break apart the company into dozens of different smaller IBMs or smaller different companies, you know, one focusing on consumer printing and then the other one on big data. And so that was kind of the mindset. And then in comes Lou Gerster, who's the new CEO, who I probably butchered his last name. But he was determined to help IBM survive and to go from this point where they were, you know, failing and everything was falling apart to figure out how to turn it around. And so he implemented what he called Operation Bear Hug, which definitely seems like, you know, it doesn't seem like an operation that a very large enterprise organization would take on. But what he did is he took his top 50 managers, like, in the company, and he sent them all around the world to visit 5 customers specifically. And so as those people went in and visited with the customers, they had the objective of not selling a single thing. They didn't want, you know, them to sell them on a new product or tell them about the new features that they have or any solutions at all. It was all focused on listening to the customer and establishing a relationship with them and hearing what it is that they're struggling with and if there's ways that IBM could possibly help in the future. So they took that and that began to work, and then they expanded out to a team of 200 people beyond the initial 50, and all those people again went and visited 5 different organizations. And so through that, that kind of sense of empathy of understanding the concerns that all these different clients were having, they began to shift the company and things began to turn around. And it also revealed opportunities that they wouldn't have thought of on their own. As a side effect, it also helped IBM be viewed as less insular and less arrogant and also more outward looking. So when we approach design, I think empathy is one of the most powerful tools that we have to be able to understand where the user's at and what they're going through and to be able to design for it and creating a connection. With empathy, there's 2 different types of empathy. One is adaptive empathy, which is based off of a mirrored response. And so this is like if you see somebody in pain and you see anguish on their face, you can instantly feel what they're feeling just because of the mirrored response, and you kind of see it obvious on them, and you can take that on yourself. But then the other side is cognitive empathy, where you begin to put yourself in that person's situation and understand what it is that they're going through, what it is that they need. And this one is what's really powerful whenever we approach it with a design context, is where we can understand the problems that people are having and what it takes to help alleviate some of those problems. What it comes down to is solving problems over our own ego as designers and what we assume and what we think is going to solve the problem. And with that, I think a lot of designers, and you know, including myself at certain times, we kind of take this mindset of we're going to push our design, and we're going to, we believe that the user or the client, if they don't like the design, then they're just, you know, they're a stupid machine, and they need help understanding how to use this design. And the problem isn't with me, or the problem isn't with our work, but it's ultimately the user that just needs to be educated. But I think that as we shift over to kind of a pull state, where we assume that people do know what they want, we assume that people do what they know what they need, but our job is to reveal it in a very elegant way to them. So it's, you know, pulling the best parts of like the human experience out of them so that we can express it through the design. There's a quote in the book of Design of Everyday Things by John Chris Jones, and he says, design everything on the assumption that people are not heartless or stupid, but marvelously capable given the chance. And Helmut Esslinger of Frog Design says, I think you should always do more than what people ask for. Or we should not look for what they ask for, but what they would like to do if they had the courage to ask for it. So I think that's where it even goes into empathy, where you can ask somebody specifically what it is that you're needing, but you have to go beyond that and understand what it is that they really would ask for if they had the courage to know what it could be like. And so as we approach the design, we have to begin to put ourselves in their position and view the user as a real person that's on the other side of that, or also a client, the way that you're presenting the work to them. I run a very small team and Style Hatch in Southern California, and it's kind of shifted from an ad agency that turned into a product company. And there was an opportunity where we saw a need with themes and designs on Tumblr platform that, you know, there was the trend towards like themes and pre-made designs. They were all very generic and they did a million different features. So we saw the opportunity to be able to come in and create something very stylish that didn't have a million features and provided somebody with what they needed to have, you know, to remove the friction in posting and expressing themselves online. And so a part of, you know, one of the core principles that you know, we found that worked in the very beginning was providing like outstanding customer service through it. And so, you know, we began to get very proactive about the way that we serve the customer, and this even goes beyond support. And so as we would see people purchasing themes, we would reach out to them on Twitter or just email them directly. You know, sometimes it would just be as simple as, you know, hey, thanks for purchasing one of our themes. But also at the same time, it gave us an opportunity to have a conversation with them about what they liked, what they don't like, and what they're trying to do. And also we could very easily visualize what people were doing with the designs that they purchased. And the response was phenomenal whenever people felt like we actually cared, you know, beyond just they paid $49 for a theme and then, you know, that was it. But they felt like, you know, we were actually understanding what it was that they want out of design and then also out of service. When we're staying here in Helsinki, we went the route of going with Airbnb to rent an apartment. Came in with my wife and three kids, so you know, we wanted somewhere where we were a little bit more comfortable. And I love the story of Airbnb and the way that they went through many, you know, starts of with the company, and they hit failure and they restarted over and over. So if you have the opportunity to read up on their beginning stage, it's fascinating to me. But they finally hit the point where they were starting to get a little bit of traction with the company. And whenever they went into the Y Combinator program, Paul Graham, the biggest thing that he said to them was, go out and meet the people. You can design, you know, the way that the service works, design the way that people post their homes and the way that people rent their homes, you know, a million different ways. But until you go out and actually physically meet with these people and stay in their homes, you're not going to understand all the opportunity that's there. And then the same thing with meetup.com. I recently had a chance to tour their office, and they were kind of talking through their whole user testing approach. And the way that they handle user testing is very different from the whole laboratory scene where, you know, they'll submit a scene, you know, a certain design or interaction and test it in a laboratory with a handful of different people. But they actually had every day of the week, they had, you know, up to five or six people that came in that they got through Craigslist or other postings. And they could, as designers, they could submit designs every morning. And even up until like an hour before they show up, they could submit a design that they want to test, whether if it's a prototype or the way an interaction works, and they can see real-time feedback. And so the designer at his desk, it's not just a video feed of the way that it works, but the designer sits there at his desk and he's watching a live video feed with the person who's trained in helping, you know, test out all these things with the users, and they can chat back and forth and begin to ask different questions and see immediately how people are reacting and what's what's actually working for them. And then even because they were testing so frequently and understanding what people need or frustrations that they had, it began to improve their product. And they would even go as far as if, you know, Instagram released a new feature on the iPhone, they would even test it. They were curious, like, you know, maybe, does this work? Does it not work? And so just frequently testing and understanding the way that people approach their design over time began to improve their product. And I love this picture. They went as lo-fi as possible, and they took a tripod and a clip and a desk lamp to create just like a really simple iPhone prototyping tool or testing tool. And so they were all about, let's just see how many people we can get in front of these designs and the feedback we can get. So as we're thinking about empathy, you know, it really comes down to really listening and understanding what it is that they're saying. Stephen Covey says, when I say empathetic listening, I mean listening with the intent to understand. I mean seeking to first understand, to really understand. It's an entirely different paradigm. Empathetic listening gets inside the other person's frame of reference. You look it through, you see the world the way that they see the world, you understand their paradigm, you understand how they feel. And this even goes into introspection. How do I, instead of introspection of sitting there and looking like, how do I or how does this design or my product fit into the world, you begin to shift the way that you think about it and think, how does this relate to the world as it is? And going with your gut and, you know, just understanding that we have instinct and we have intuition, especially after we really begin to listen, we can understand and begin to make guesses and hunches about what really is going to connect. But ultimately, we have to test it. We have to understand, does this work, does this not work? And then the other aspect of, you know, going beyond pixels on the external side of things is experience. Companies that are loved will win, almost always. In Southern California, we have Disneyland, and you know, it's just like a wonderful place, and you think, you know, if you were to go out and set up a whole entire experience around a whole, you know, collection of intellectual property, like there's a lot of different ways you could do it, and you would think you could just combine all these different things, and it would work, and it would create that experience, but there's actually some things that they purposely did in the design to craft an experience for people whenever they come into the park and the way that they interact with everything in the park. The first one is perspective, and so if you've ever been there, you walk into the gates and you see a big train station that's blocking your view of the rest of the park. And as you go into the park, you go under this little tunnel, under a bridge, and the purpose of that is to reset your perspective. The way that everything was on the outside world, now that you're inside the park, they can begin to adjust and present perspective in a very different light, and it begins to work with your mind and the way that you view everything. Even down to the size and the scale of the way that the buildings and the objects are set up. As you're walking down Main Street, they have all these buildings that are three-story buildings, but the way that they kind of approach it is the first floor is a normal height, the second floor and the third floor are just for show, but the second floor may only be 50% as tall, and the third 30%. So it kind of gives you the sense of you know, these tall buildings that are all around you, and as you begin to go down the street or look down the street, they begin to adjust those perspectives. And so it creates like visual trick with your eye, and you see the castle and everything looks bigger, and you begin to feel smaller in comparison to everything around you. And even down to the big objects that they have and the way that the paths are set up so that you always feel oriented and you know where you're at in the park, and you know you can see the castle within view, or you can see this ride within view, and those were purposely done so that you understand where you are in relationship to the park at all times. And then the delightful details, the little things, the very subtle things that you wouldn't think people would notice or pay attention to, but they spend a lot of time making sure that all the details across the board are polished. Design discoveries. They purposely created things that is one of those things, once you know and understand that this is here, this little hidden feature is here, you want to tell other people about it, or you feel like you're a part of, you know, the elite because you discovered something that most people wouldn't see or understand. And then personal storytelling. So there's a lot of stories that they're telling as you go through the rides or as you're going through the park. But the biggest thing that they focused on is not necessarily the story that they're telling to you, but rather the story that you're going to tell about your experience with the park. And so I think, you know, looking at Disneyland, that's obvious. Like, there's a lot of opportunity to do fun stuff with that. But then you switch over to product design, and, you know, how can you begin to apply those same experience things to product design? This is plan scope, and they look at budgeting and time management and figuring out ways that you can express that to clients. And so, you know, a part of the sign-up process, they made it as simple as possible. You don't have to put in, you know, a credit card number or anything like that. You just put in your email address, choose a password, and get started. And so they begin to guide you through the entire process, and the first thing that you see is a little note from the founder, and he begins to guide you through the process. And there's even design discoveries where, you know, there's these screens helping you understand the ways that you can use the product. And a part of that, you can even begin to interact with it. So as this product is becoming unveiled to you, you're understanding how it works and how you can begin to use it. And then whenever you're dropped off into the application, you don't have just a completely empty screen. They start you off with a project so that you have that reference point as you're going in. Or even Intercom, which handles, you know, user metrics and understanding the way that people are using your product and reaching out to them. It's very targeted towards developers, but at the same time, you know, they've made choices about the way that you implement it and make it as easy as possible to be able to set it up and get it going. And these are all experiences that were purposely created to kind of, you know, lower the barriers and lower the friction to be able to use these products as easily as possible. People don't want to buy what you do, they buy why you do it. And so a lot of that goes into the story and the story that you are creating for the user. Product design ultimately isn't about what it is going to look like, it's about what it's going to do. There's a brand consultancy in Boston that I know the founder, and he puts branding in this light. A brand is an experience living at the intersection of a promise and an expectation. And so I think that right there kind of sums up what the experience is you have, you know, a promise of this is what my product's going to do, and the user has the expectation of this is what I expect it to do. But if you kind of blow that out a little bit more, you get into delight. And these are the things that make the experience feel special and unique and puts somebody in that story. There's a new ice cream place that just opened up nearby, and they kind of take a different approach. They have really fancy ice cream like chocolate lavender and avocado flavored and salted caramel, all these kind of crazy stuff. But, you know, the one thing that they did really well was they created an experience around the ice cream, and they used liquid nitrogen to make the ice cream, you know, right there. But, you know, a part of it makes me wonder how much of the theatrics and the experience play into the way that you taste the ice cream. Because, you know, these just came from Instagram, just looking at the location, searching by location, and you see people telling the story and telling about the experience they had that was very different and unique, and that's what kind of like began to establish something that's different and delightful. So you have usable and you have delightful. And I think that, you know, so much has been focused on, you know, what is usable, but I think we need to take it a step further and figure out, like, what is the minimal delightful product? And what is it that we can do to make something delightful? There's enough, we can put enough into the design and little deep design details, and people will think that the experience is well designed, but we need to begin to look at, you know, it in a little bit of a broader sense, where does it give somebody delight? So even with Style Hatch, when we first started it, we're selling website designs and themes and templates, all this type of stuff. We didn't even have a website for ourselves. For the first 10 months of the company, we had no website. I mean, we were directly on the Tumblr platform selling there, and we focus completely on the service experience. And it wasn't even necessarily like we had so many problems or so many issues that, that people had to email us in, but we were encouraging people to email in because we used that as research and we began to see the way that people were using it. And we even used this up to the point where, you know, we did about $500,000 in revenue before we even thought about having a website. Or looking at Woofoo, they do embedded forms on websites and they make it really easy. But every Friday in the beginning days of the company, they would actually spend time sitting down and writing handwritten thank you notes to all their customers. You know, it's so cheesy and it's so, you know, kind of crazy. Like they would just write thanks, and I found a whole bunch of them on the internet, and they all have dinosaur stickers on the front, and then on the backside, they actually wrote a note and sent these out to all the customers. It's such a little thing, and it costs them so little money, but it changed somebody's perception of the experience of the product and gave them a feeling that, you know, this is something different. This is something I can tell people about. Or even Warby Parker. They sell, you know, very interesting, low-cost, stylish glasses. And they even have a charitable component where for every pair of glasses that they sell, they provide somebody who needs glasses. But, you know, they even kind of go beyond that of whenever you purchase the product, it's almost like an unboxing experience of pulling the glasses out. And, you know, they have services where if you're not sure which glasses you want, you can send in up to 5 pairs and they mail all 5 to you and then you just return the ones that you don't want. So the key here is designing for an experience instead of designing the experience. So whenever you're planning like the conference or a party, you think through all the details and the experience that you want somebody to have, but you ultimately can't plan the experience for them. Otherwise, it's going to feel forced and it's going to feel hollow and empty. But whenever you lay the groundwork of all these delightful details, it begins to craft an experience. And so going into that, again, it's the promise of what it we say this will do, the expectation of what the user thinks it'll do, and then also the delight that they get out of it. And so, you know, as designers today, we have so many new paths and so many new directions that we can go, and we have designers that just design, designers who design and code, or even, you know, trailblaze and go, you know, you're freelancing or you're starting a company, you know, there's a lot of different paths. And early on in my career, I had a chance to work at, you know, in the flash industry at TooAdvance and Blitz Agency, and you know, it was very heavy in the whole flash era, and like we made the skip intro button really famous, you know, and a lot of that was fluff, and it was completely, you know, there wasn't a lot of purpose to it, but at the same time, it began to it created an emotion, and it was there on purpose to create an emotion. But over time, like as you know, I went off on my own and started working with other clients, learned how to focus the right emotions to, you know, to actually add value and to sell the designs, whether to the client or to the end user, through empathy and with experience. You know, even with Style Hatch, it all began with a small idea. I never intended to get into selling themes or a theme business. But it was just one of those small ideas, thinking, you know, maybe it would buy my lunch every day. And in between two clients, I launched the first theme. But it kind of grew from there and turned into, you know, something unexpected. If an opportunity does not knock, build a door. So, you know, it's just a matter of figuring out, you know, what are the paths as a designer? What do I want to do? You know, as a designer, you can work at a great agency, you can build an agency, you can freelance, you can write software, write a book. There's so many different paths that we have today at our disposal that we can go down. And then quickly looking at the internal and the things beyond pixels internally that will help us approach design in a better way. And again, looking at becoming conscious about these practices and these things that we do and putting them into play to help us with our design process. How do you fuel your creativity? What is it that you do that kind of fuels you creatively? I mean, ultimately, it's going to come down to you as an individual, what it is that works for you to fuel it, but how much thought do you put into your practice of fueling creativity? You know, whenever I was thinking through, you know, what it is that kind of helps fuel creativity and also at the same time kills creativity, you know, I came up with these four things. One is clarity and understanding, you know, what am I working for? What is the purpose of my design and the work? And boiling it all down to one thing. And I think that whenever we begin to get scattered and distracted with a million different things, it really stifles and kills creativity. Relationships, like, you know, having events like this where all the designers of the city and this area kind of come together, it gives you a chance to get to know other people in this room, and it also spurs on creativity like you know, in a bunch of different ways. The same thing with clients and customers and just average people that you have conversations with. They will say something that will just kind of fuel a moment of creativity. Energy. You know, I early on in career, like I would work all-nighters and weekends and just constantly working, but realizing that we're running a marathon here. This is not a sprint, and figuring out, you know, what are certain things that I can do and put into play so I'm not going to be burnt out 10 years from now or 5 years from now. And then input. What is it that you're putting in to fuel your creativity? Are you just looking at the visual for inspiration, or are you looking at psychology books or different ways to approach, you know, the way that you think about design? And then action. This is another big, you know, important point to me. And, you know, ideas alone don't change the world for the better, but ideas that inspire actions do have the potential to change the world. Thomas Edison says that genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. I love this this chart and this kind of breakdown that Derek Silvers put together, where he talks about ideas and execution. They're multipliers of each other. So you can have, you know, on the left you have your range of ideas from awful to brilliant, and then execution from no execution to brilliant, and you have to multiply the two to figure out the value of what it is that you're working on, what it is that you're creating. And so you can have the most brilliant idea, but with no execution, it's worth $20. You know, I mean, you could tell somebody the plan before Facebook did it. You could tell somebody this whole plan, but that idea alone is only worth about $20. You know, but if you even look at like a weak idea with great execution, you know, I mean, that's worth something, and you know, it actually has value. But if you even go beyond that and you take match a brilliant idea with brilliant execution, there's all sorts of potential there. There's a quote by Howard Aiken that says, "Don't worry about people stealing your ideas. If your ideas are any good, you'll have to ram it down people's throats." And so a lot of that comes down to the way that you execute, and you actually have to push it forward. This last summer, the whole notion of action, you know, became really important to me personally. I mentioned I have all three of my kids with me here in Helsinki, and my 3.5-year-old son, last summer at the time he was 2, you know, my kids, they all swim fairly well and can get around in a pool, but, you know, we're outside and swimming with some other friends, and we had, you know, a bunch of kids over, and at one point I look over and my daughter, she stepped on a bee and she got a bee sting on her foot, and so we went over to help her, and we're kind of a little bit distracted, and next thing we know, here comes another bee. And another one, and like they're starting to swarm around. So, you know, we're thinking, oh, you know, maybe like just the process of killing one of the bees, like it attracted all the others. So I thought, you know what, I'll scoop up all the bees and go throw it away in the house. And right about the time that I threw it away, I hear my wife scream, and I look outside, and she's jumping into the hot tub. And I'm thinking, you know, she like get attacked by some bees, or are they swarming her? You know, there's a lot of things going on in my mind. And I rush outside, and that's when I get to like the edge of the water, and I look down and I see my son at the bottom of the hot tub. And she pulls him out, and he's purple and he's not breathing, and she hands him to me. And you know, in that moment, there's all sorts of thoughts racing through your mind. You know, what am I dealing with? Is he alive? You know, he feels cold, he's purple. You know, I don't officially know CPR. I'm not certified with CPR, but I just knew in that moment, like, I have to do something. You know, I've seen enough YouTube videos or movies where I've seen CPR done, so I lay him down on the ground, and I just began to do what I thought I needed to do. And you know, through that process, when we eventually ended up at the ICU and the hospital, and everything was fine, everything went absolutely perfect, and there was nothing, you know, that coming out of that situation that really, you know, stayed with him. There was one interaction that I had with the pediatrician where he said, you just have to do something. That's ultimately what it comes down to. So many people in a situation where they encounter a situation where they have to take action, they lock up and they freeze up. But you don't have to have the right techniques. You don't have to have the right ways of doing it. You just simply have to do something. And so that's one of the lessons that I learned through that hit me really deeply, where, you know, you don't have to have all the answers. You don't have to have everything together. You just have to do something. So what holds us back from action? What holds us back from these ideas that we have to actually executing and making them a reality? Ultimately, it's fear. You know, but at the same time, if you think about, you know, what are the characteristics of fear? You know, you're sweating, your heart is racing, you're focused on your attention. But those are also the same things that happens whenever you're excited. And so just beginning to understand, like, you know, this I'm onto something, you know, I'm feeling some fear because, you know, this could potentially be something, and the risk that I'm taking actually, you know, could amount to something. You know, there's a quote that I love about, like, entrepreneurship. It says, entrepreneurs aren't the ones with the best ideas. They're just the ones willing to jump off a cliff without answers. And I feel like so many times, like that, you know, there's times where I'm dealing with a client, you know, or I land a big client and I don't really know what I'm doing. I don't understand, you know, how I necessarily got them as a client, or, you know, what their expectations are of me. But I know that, you know what, I just got to jump in and, you know, let's figure it out as we go. You know, whether if it's starting a company or going in freelance for yourself, or even leading a design team with an agency, we're constantly faced with those situations where you just got to jump in, and you may not have the answers, but you got to do it. And then just to, you know, as you're going into action and putting some of these ideas into action, you know, we always have these moments where we're super inspired and you know, we know what we're going to do and we have all the answers, and then you start working on the project, and then you hit this process where you're kind of in this dip where, you know, you're not as excited about the project, but you have to just push it forward. And so the things that I've found is, you know, when you get in that moment, you just have to keep the progress going and keep the ball rolling and moving forward. And it goes back to that idea of an empty Photoshop, you know, file or a document that you're writing. You just have to keep moving and moving forward, and it'll progress. And then traction is whenever you actually have some momentum behind what it is that you're doing, and it'll help drive the process forward. And then again, thinking about the process, the things that we do and the things that we actively apply to our design, you know, what are we doing to kind of fuel that process? And then discipline, just showing up every day and just keep on, you know, perfecting what it is that we're doing and our design and the way that we interact with users and our clients. So, you know, is kind of like shifting, you know, and wrapping up. You know, if you go to this URL here, I have a form, and you know, I would love if you go there and put in your email address, and, you know, from the conference, not necessarily from my talk, but I have two questions as far as, you know, what is it that you're going to do to kind of really consciously think about your process beyond pixels, both internally and externally. If you could fill it out, and I'll follow up with every single one personally, and you know, I kind of encourage you in the process. And I think what it ultimately comes down to is, you know, are you creating your best work? Are you, you know, at the end of the day, the work that you created today, are you happy with it, or is it something that you feel like you you know, really added value to the clients or the users? And that's it.